All we have worked with until now have been things that supply power and things that use power, namely sources and resistors. While this may seem like some sort of nice symbiotic relationship, without the whole bio component, it screams of one of those, there are two types of whatever in the universe. If the universe were really that boring that we could fit everything into just a couple of groups, the banality of existence would be unbearable, unless there were a nearly infinite number of non-correlated groups. Thankfully, the universe and electronics are much more interesting than just having things that supply energy and things that consume energy. While on some level that argument might be made, there is enough variation to make things interesting. Don't worry, we're not going to delve too deeply into the complexities of electronics today. We're just going to add one concept, or class of components as it were, energy storage devices. Specifically, I will begin by talking about something called a capacitor. A capacitor is an electrical component that is capable of storing electrical energy. Its energy storage is based upon a combination of two ancient principles. One, opposites attract, which was probably figured out by some ancient Greeks playing with magnets, though in the context of capacitors, it is more formally attributed to Coulomb, since we're dealing with positive and negative charges. And two, the only way to keep them apart is to use some sort of physical barrier, which we could likely attribute to the Chinese, or to the first parents of teenagers. Let's say we have two charges, Q1 and Q2, and for fun, let's pretend charge 1 is fixed in space. The force exerted on charge 2 is expressed mathematically in terms of Coulomb's law, which can be written as the force is equal to a magical constant times the product of charges divided by the square of the distance between the charges. If the charges are of the same type, for example both positive, the force will be repulsive and Q2 will have a force that will move it to the right. If the charges are opposite charges, the force on Q2 would move it to the left. Now let's consider a situation where we have two conductors separated by a space. If we placed a positive charge on the top plate and a negative charge on the bottom plate, there would be an attractive force between them. However, because the charges are immaterial and there is a space between them, they would not actually be able to move toward each other. Like some tragic love story, they would just have to stare at each other across the chasm of space, ever longing but never being able to come together. Enough of that. For every positive charge we put on the top plate, a negative charge could be held on the bottom plate. Eventually, either we would run out of charges to add, or the plates would be as full of charge as they could be. Then all of the charge would just sit on each of the plates, being pulled towards the opposite plate but not being able to make any net movement towards the other plate. So the attractive force between them can be related to a potential energy that is stored in the system that we are learning is a capacitor. A capacitance is the ability to store electrical energy in the form of charge with respect to electric potential, or mathematically, capacitance equals charge over voltage. It is measured in a unit called the farad, named in honor of Michael Faraday, where 1 farad is 1 coulomb per volt. Now 1 farad is a lot of capacitance. If we take a situation we described of 2 parallel plates, the capacitance of 2 parallel plates is given by something called the permittivity of free space, a constant equal to 8.5 times 10 to the negative 12 farads per meter, times the area of the plates divided by the separation of the plates. If the plates were separated by 1 centimeter and the plates were square, they would have to be more than 20 miles on each side to have 1 farad of capacitance, not a very practical component. When we are talking about capacitors as components, we are generally dealing with capacitances between picofarads up to hundreds of microfarads. So if a capacitor requires a lot of area to increase the capacitance, what are some ways that we can increase the capacitance without needing an unreasonable amount of geometric space? One thing that can increase the capacitance of the component would be to decrease the separation between the plates, sometimes down to tens of microns. This can dramatically reduce the area needed to make a particular capacitor. I am not just stuck with geometry either. The permittivity of free space can be replaced with the permittivity of a better insulator, with a much higher permittivity such as ceramic, plastic, or oxide. This will increase the capacitance also. I can also adjust the geometry of the parallel plates by doing something like making a sandwich out of the conductors and insulators and then rolling them up, making a nice compact cylinder. There are more complex and involved ways of making capacitors, and there are many different types of capacitors, each type being optimized for certain properties over certain range of operation. The details of that are not necessary now, so I'll return to the basic properties of the capacitor. Let's assume we have a capacitor. If we apply a constant voltage to the capacitor, it will charge, and once it is full, no more charge can be added to the capacitor. The capacitor will just store the charge it has, in theory, forever. In reality, some of the charge will slowly leak out. A charged capacitor is pretty boring. However, if the voltage across the capacitor changes in time, the charge will move onto and off of the capacitor. In fact, The current through the capacitor is related to the change in the voltage across the capacitor. Mathematically, we can say that the current through the capacitor is equal to the capacitance times the derivative of the voltage with respect to time. If the voltage across the capacitor is constant, the derivative of the voltage is zero, and therefore the current through the capacitor is 0 amps. A less mathematical way of stating that is that capacitors block DC current. The other extreme we could look at would be a voltage that changes very, very quickly. We can look at this by assuming the interval over which a voltage changes becomes vanishingly small. In this case, as the change in voltage per unit time approaches infinity, the current through the capacitor approaches infinity. That's fine on paper, unless the paper actually becomes a singularity, but in physical reality, infinities do not occur. Practically, this means that the voltage across a capacitor cannot change instantaneously. These are two of the basic properties that capacitors have that are useful. They can be used to block DC current. This is useful in situations where DC can be harmful, such as magnetically actuated speakers. They can also be used to limit how quickly voltage can change. This is useful in preventing voltage spikes that can damage electronics. Let's take another look at the current voltage relationship for the capacitor. While this may make some mathematicians unhappy, if we multiply through by dt, which is an operator and not a variable, then with a bit of quick mathematical manipulation and integration of both sides, we find that the voltage across the capacitor is proportional to the integral of the current. From our earlier discussion, we know that capacitors are energy storage devices. Can we calculate the stored energy? Starting with the things we know, power is the rate of change of energy, and power is equal to voltage times current. We can substitute the capacitor voltage for the voltage, and the capacitor current we have from a few minutes ago. Putting them together, we have a relationship between power and the capacitor voltage. A touch of ninja math sets us up to look at the following integrals, where we integrate from some initial time t, 0, to the time we're interested in. The integration of power with respect to time gives us the energy at time t minus the energy at the initial time. And integration of the voltage gives us voltage at time t squared minus the initial capacitor voltage squared. This is a pretty complicated looking equation, so for now let's assume the capacitor initially had no voltage across it and therefore no initial stored energy. Then we can say that the energy stored in the capacitor is proportional to the square of the voltage across it. If we had a 20 volt DC source attached to a 10 microfarad capacitor, we can use this equation to determine the energy stored in the capacitor. We simply substitute the capacitance and the voltage into the equation. Then the energy stored would be 1/2 times 10 microfarads times 20 volts squared, which gives us 2 millijoules. This energy would be stored in the capacitor even if we disconnected it from the voltage supply. So how much energy is 2 millijoules? It's about the kinetic energy an airsoft pellet would have when it hit the ground if it were dropped from a height of just under 6 feet. This is not much, but remember that many modern electrical devices are very tiny and a small amount of energy can go a long way. Also, capacitors are not power supplies or batteries. They are passive electronic components and are generally not used to supply a lot of stored energy. What about a slightly more complicated circuit? Let's look at a circuit with the same DC source and capacitor, but this time we have a couple of resistors with them. If we assume that the circuit has been connected for a long time, like a couple tenths of a second, then we can assume that the capacitor is charged and the circuit is in a DC condition. This means that the capacitor acts as an open circuit. Even though the capacitor is an open circuit, it can still store energy. That's because the energy stored in the capacitor is dependent upon the voltage across it, not the current through it. Let's calculate that energy. If no current passes through the capacitor, the resistors form a voltage divider. The 4 kilo-ohm resistor is in parallel with the capacitor, so the voltage across it is a voltage across the capacitor. Writing the voltage divider equation for the 4 kilo ohm resistor, we find the voltage across the resistor and therefore the capacitor is 4 volts. We can then calculate the energy stored in the capacitor using the equation we just developed and determine that the energy stored in the capacitor is 80 microjoules. Before we leave our introduction to capacitors, we should take a look at one more thing. If we had a network of resistors, we would know how to determine an equivalent resistance. What if we had a network of capacitors? Let's start with two capacitors in parallel. Beginning by indicating the currents and voltages present, we can write a KCL equation for the parallel combination. The current entering the combination divides between the two capacitors. We can then substitute the current voltage relationship for a capacitor into the equation. Since the capacitors are in parallel, the voltages V1 and V2 are equal, so we can substitute V in for each of them. We can then factor the derivative out of the equation, showing us the two capacitances add to an equivalent capacitance. So, to combine parallel capacitances, we simply add the capacitances together. If we think back to the equation for parallel plate capacitor, another way to think of this is that two capacitors in parallel have more area than a single capacitor. This would obviously increase the capacitance. I will leave it up to you to convince yourself that this is true for any number of capacitances in parallel. And what about series capacitors? Again, let's start by indicating the currents and voltages that are present. If we do a KVL equation around the loop, we see that the voltage divides between the two capacitors. Substituting the current voltage relationship for capacitors, we can then note that, since the two capacitors are in series, they have the same current going through them. So we can substitute I in for the two currents. We can then factor the integral out. We see that we can write the sum of the reciprocals of the capacitance as the reciprocal of an equivalent capacitor. To combine series capacitors, we add the reciprocals of the capacitances together. Again, if we think about the equation for parallel plate capacitors, we can think of the distance between the two outer plates increasing, which would reduce the overall capacitance. Wow, that sure was a lot. So, a quick review. Capacitors are energy storage devices. That means they are fundamentally different from resistors. Rather than simply using energy and power, they can store energy. Capacitance itself is a ratio of charge stored to the electric potential and is measured in farads. We saw that the current voltage relationship for a capacitor was differential, and from this, we determined that a capacitor looks like an open circuit to DC signals. We also saw that if you're trying to change the voltage across a capacitor instantaneously, the current would become infinite. Since that is impossible, it will resist instantaneous voltage changes. We determined how to calculate the energy stored in a capacitor, and that the energy was related to the voltage across the capacitor. We then looked at how we might solve simple DC circuits containing capacitors. Finally, we figured out how to combine series and parallel capacitances. There's a lot more we can learn about capacitors, but for now, this is a reasonable introduction. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.